from WFAA TV Channel 8, the spirit of Texas. This is the News 8 Update.
Personally, fantastic. I think it's taken too long.
Reaction tonight to news father Rudy Koss is behind bars in California, awaiting transfer back to Texas.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for joining us. Channel 8 News tonight has confirmed that Koss was arrested in San Diego this afternoon. He is wanted locally on 8 felony counts in connection with the alleged molestation of altar boys at St. Luke's Catholic Church in Irving during the 1980s. Channel 8's Brett Chip joins us now live from the newsroom with more. Brett?
Chip, Father Rudy Koss was already awaiting trial back here in Dallas on sexual assault charges when this afternoon around 2 o'clock, San Diego police arrested him at a downtown bar. Police say he was upset but was taken into custody without incident. He was booked into the San Diego County Jail where he is being held tonight on $400,000 bond. He was arrested on 1 count of sexual assault, 3 counts of aggravated sexual assault, and 4 counts of indecency with a child. These are new charges against Koss, who faces trial here in Dallas on 2 other sexual assault charges. Koss is the Catholic priest and youth counselor who allegedly molested 11 Dallas area altar boys back in the 80s. Koss has already been found civilly liable for those molestations, and this summer, the Catholic Diocese of Dallas was sued by the alleged victims and lost a $119 million judgment. One of those victims, Tony Miglini of Dallas, says he's relieved and excited to hear Koss is back in jail.
We just got to make sure that he did a lot of bad things, and if he could go to jail for all of them, I think that would be great, but as long as he goes to jail, as long as that's the bottom line, that's what really matters.
Just a few moments ago, we talked to a spokesperson for the Dallas Catholic Diocese who gave this response, quote, "The diocese applauds the fact that criminal charges have been filed. The church has asked Rome to nullify Koss's priestly orders, which is the most serious action that can be taken. It is now up to the Dallas County District Attorney to draw up extradition papers to have Koss brought back to Dallas to be formally charged. No word yet when that might happen." John, back to you.
All right, thanks a lot, Brett. The former superintendent of Dallas Public Schools is now a convicted felon. Yvonne Gonzalez today pleaded guilty to misappropriating thousands of dollars in school district funds. It was her first public appearance since the scandal at DISD broke 4 weeks ago. Channel 8's Doug Wilson was there.
We have no comment at this time.
Yvonne Gonzalez had nothing to say to reporters on her way into federal court.
That's
the silence is a switch for the one-time high-profile and talkative superintendent who billed herself as a school district reformer. Inside, the flashes popped away and cameras rolled as Gonzalez made her way to the courtroom.
My attorneys have said they'd like to make a statement on my behalf.
Standing before U.S. District Court Judge Jorge Solis, Gonzalez agreed to plead guilty to a single count of misappropriating funds. This allows her to avoid prosecution on more serious charges of witness tampering and obstruction of justice. Before the plea, the federal prosecutor detailed Gonzalez's crime and explained how her assistant, Frida Jinks, reported her to the FBI. Jinks told investigators she and Gonzalez bought a $10,000 bedroom set last January with school district money, then covered up the purchase with falsified documents. Gonzalez later had the bedroom set moved to her Cole Avenue apartment. But when Gonzalez learned the FBI was investigating, she phoned Jinks, urged her to lie about the scheme, and then told her to take the secret to their graves. The FBI recorded the entire conversation. And while Gonzalez declined to talk with reporters, her attorney did.
She's extremely remorseful. To use your word, she's very repentant for what has happened, what she's done. She's accepted responsibility for what she's done.
Outside the federal court building, African-American leaders called for the resignation of DISD Board President Kathleen Laos. They fought Laos for supporting Gonzalez after allegations of wrongdoing surfaced.
We say they are connected at the hip, and we think it's time for her to go in order that we begin to purge the concerns that are missed in this district.
Under the terms of the plea agreement, Gonzalez gave up her right to appeal her sentence or to change her plea in all but a few special cases. Sentencing is scheduled for mid-January. Doug Wilson, Channel 8 News.
Gonzalez could get probation, a fine of up to $200,000, or up to 10 years in prison.
Four men are in custody tonight for an early morning double murder and fire in Fort Worth. Police say the men killed two young women and then burned their apartment to try to cover up the crime. Channel 8's Jim Douglas says police got a break when one suspect returned to the scene in the 2800 block of West Wind Circle.
When Fort Worth firefighters arrived about 1:30 a.m., a good Samaritan had already pulled one woman's body from the burning apartment and returned to answer the cries of a child.
I couldn't see the child at all because the smoke was so thick.
But you could hear
it? Yes, I could hear the child crying. So I crawled in about 2 feet in. It was just so thick, and I just started screaming, "Come here, come here, come here."
Frank Payne Jr. dragged a four-year-old boy to safety. The child was taken by care flight to Parkland Hospital, leaving behind his mother and her roommate, one dead, the other mortally wounded. Police say the boy and a friend of the woman survived by staying in the bathroom. Investigators got a break immediately as they interviewed bystanders, including 18-year-old Waylon Harris.
Mr. Harris's story started to become inconsistent. As the detectives continued to question him, he ended up confessing to being a party to this offense and provided us with the names of three other individuals.
Police quickly arrested the others, 24-year-old James Odom, 21-year-old David Grismore, and a 16-year-old boy. Odom is the brother-in-law of one of the victims, and according to the arrest affidavit, the man who planned the assault as matter-of-factly as laying out a business deal. Detectives say he enlisted the others to help him rob, rape, and kill the women, and burn the apartment to get rid of evidence.
This is a heinous offense. You got three innocent victims, basically one a four-year-old child.
Homicide Sergeant Paul Kratz says the women were stabbed repeatedly. One of them was also strangled and may have been sexually assaulted.
Three of the four suspects, including the juvenile, have criminal records. The adults now face capital murder charges and $500,000 bonds. And the juvenile may also be tried as an adult. Jim Douglas, Channel 8 News, Fort Worth.
Authorities have not yet released the names of the victims. Police say the husband of one woman is in the military overseas.
Former Congressman Dan Rostenkowski has served his time. The former head of the powerful House Ways and Means Committee has spent 451 days in federal custody on corruption charges. He wouldn't comment to reporters as he left the Chicago halfway house this morning. Rostenkowski will be on probation for the next 2 years. He will continue to receive a federal pension of nearly $100,000 a year, just as he did behind bars. The latest on the investigation into White House fundraising, the release today of 90 more hours of fundraising videotape.
But saddle up and don't get tired, because we got a long way to go between now and November.
White House lawyers say the tapes are proof the president did not break the law, but the videotapes do show a chief executive zealously searching for money, meeting with a number of controversial Democratic donors. The tapes include a 1995 Oval Office visit. President Clinton later told aides made him uncomfortable. Entrepreneur Johnny Chung brought in several businessmen from China and now claims he made a $50,000 contribution for the opportunity.
Republicans say those tapes are yet another reason Janet Reno should appoint an independent counsel to investigate the president. And some members of Congress told her so today as the Attorney General testified before the House Judiciary Committee. Republicans warned Reno that the polls show that the American people are losing confidence in her office. Reno replied her primary concern is the evidence and the law.
The average citizen has a right to ask, what's taking you so long? The answer is simple. We need to do it right.
And while the fundraising investigation goes forward, President Clinton continues the first presidential tour of South America. From one of Brazil's poorest slums, Clinton today pushed his case for open trade, saying more jobs and better schooling can raise living standards.
There's a huge financial deal in the works tonight with North Texas Ties. GTE is wooing MCI, capping a torrid year of merger courtship, and it's offering cold, hard cash. Channel 8's Byron Harris has more.
From air phones to pay phones to rural phone systems, GTE has a national presence. Now it's wooing long-distance carrier MCI, but it's not the first. Earlier this year, MCI had agreed to merge with British Telecom in a deal valued at $21 billion. But then WorldCom came along with an offer of $30 billion in cash and stock, and MCI started having second thoughts. And now comes GTE with an offer of $28 billion, all of it in cash.
You've got the prospect of two major corporations, one like GTE with enormous local access and local customer base, and a major provider of long distance like MCI, coming together, giving both the customers access to enormous networks and power and services.
GTE has significant manpower in North Texas with a networking headquarters in Irving. It's in the process of moving the whole company to Texas from Connecticut. But it says if the deal goes through, it will move instead to Washington, D.C. But before anything happens, MCI must take the offer and federal regulators must approve it. They will take a hard look at the deal.
I think the competition would be very worried about a merger like this because it would, in effect, give these companies, as one single marketing unit, an enormous advantage in the marketplace.
In 1982, the telecommunications industry was transformed when a federal judge ordered the dismantling of AT&T. Now, 15 years later, the industry is trying to put itself back together again. This deal shows how much it's worth. Byron Harris, Channel 8 News.
If accepted, the deal would still take months of government scrutiny before it could be approved.
Communicating through computers, for some, it's the only answer. And now, a place called the Discovery Room is giving them new and improved options. And 8 Listens report for you next.
Also, a new study reveals concerns about a drug you've probably used more than once as a painkiller.
And despite protests, the Cassini spacecraft is Saturn-bound tonight. We'll be right back.
You have the paper? I'd really like to buy it. Can you call me back at 764?
Yeah, I'd like to come over and see the car tonight if it's okay with my parole officer.
$8,500 for that car?
Maybe selling your car yourself doesn't sound like such a good idea after all.
Can I come right now?
CarMax. We'll give you money for your car in under an hour.
Look out! Because this Halloween, Toys R Us is your Halloween headquarters. You'll find every trick or treat under the moon. A monstrous selection of costumes and a dungeon full of decorations. At prices so low, you'll howl. So this Halloween, bring the entire family to Toys R Us for a Halloween selection so huge. It's scary. You know those dress pants that go from work to after work without missing a beat?
And there was an accident on the bridge, and they tore up 3rd Street.
These are slates.
I hope you're not stuck someplace.
From Levi Strauss & Company.
This is Imagine TV.
Welcome to the biggest event of the year, the Imagine TV Awards, honoring Mercury's best. For the government's highest crash test rating, the winner is Mercury Grand Marquis. Number one in owner loyalty and the Southwest best-selling full-size car, the V8-powered Grand Marquis. Plus, only Grand Marquis rewards you with rear-wheel drive. And now, an additional prize, 2,000 cash back or 1.9% APR for 48 months. See the award-winning Grand Marquis today.
Till next time, imagine yourself in a Mercury.
Este noticiero es transmitido en español por KRVA, Radio Variedades, 1600 AM.
A Dallas man is suing TCU in a case that could have a major impact on colleges nationwide. Kent Waldrop was paralyzed in 1974 while playing football for TCU. He's now asking the court to treat an athlete as an employee of the university. That would entitle him to workers' compensation and reimbursement for medical expenses. A verdict in favor of Waldrop could lead to an avalanche of lawsuits by athletes hurt while playing college sports. Today, Waldrop is the president of the National Paralysis Foundation in Dallas.
You know, these days, computers can help the disabled accomplish some pretty amazing things. During a recent News 8 Listens meeting with the United Cerebral Palsy of Metro Dallas, we learned computers also give some people a chance to do some pretty basic things, as Channel 8's Doug Fox reports.
Two-year-old Jasmine makes a computer sound like a burping hunk of modern machinery just by touching the screen.
5-year-old Shawty makes a fuzzy elephant snort. The same techniques these children use to operate electrical toys will someday allow them to operate a microwave, a blender, or a computer.
And then this little button here.
Welcome to the Discovery Room, learning and training center for people with disabilities. Here, modern technology unlocks and unleashes what oftentimes remains trapped inside a body that can't talk, walk, or function like everybody else. For Michael Wright, the computer represents a vital link to the future.
Independence. It's independence. It's him doing it, nobody else, on his own.
Using a computer, Michael graduated with honors, won 2 scholarships, and now he's going to college. A small dot stuck to his forehead reflects a light beam that operates the computer's mouse. By moving his head, he can play cards, write papers, and communicate with the verbal world. Across the room, Marcy Simmons uses keyboard scanning software and a big button to write a letter to her mom and dad. What works for one person might not work for another, so United Cerebral Palsy of Metro Dallas created this center to give people like Marcy and Michael a chance to decide what's best for them before they spend a lot of money on computer equipment.
So what we're trying to do is kind of bridge a gap for people. There's a lot of equipment, hardware, software, input, output devices that are available for computers, but many times people just can't access them. They can't use them.
What Michael learns on a new computer system today will help him be a landscape architect tomorrow.
That's his dream, that's his goal, and then eventually to have his own business. But he's always loved plants and animals.
You have any doubts in your own mind that he'll make it?
No, he's gonna make it. He's proved me wrong too many times. He's gonna make it.
For News 8 Listens, Doug Fox, Channel 8 News.
And if you would like to volunteer your time or donate some computer equipment to train people who are mentally or physically disabled, contact United Cerebral Palsy of Metro Dallas. The phone number is 214-351-2500. And if you'd like a News 8 Listens team to meet with your group, call us at Metro 972-988-8888 or send us an email at 8listens@wfaa.com.
The UT Southwestern Medical Center in Dallas released a study today that should interest anyone who takes Tylenol products. The study looked at what happens when a person takes excessive doses of acetaminophen, the active ingredient in Tylenol. It reviewed records of 589 drug overdose patients at Parkland Hospital from 1992 to 95. Of the 71 treated for taking too much acetaminophen, 50 were suicidal, but 21 were accidental. The study found alcohol a factor in most of the accidental overdoses.
It has dose-related toxicity, so that if they exceed what's on the package labeling, they can expect to see toxicity. That is liver injury, that is severe hepatitis or liver coma, actually leading to coma and death in some instances.
But McNeil Consumer Products, which makes Tylenol, said there's no clear data to suggest that there's a risk of taking 8 tablets a day regardless of alcohol consumption. You have to take a lot of alcohol and exceed the recommended dosage. The study appears in the New England Journal of Medicine tomorrow.
Well, hopefully the school kids are asleep, but today would have been a great day to play hooky. It was just gorgeous outside.
And as you pointed out, a beautiful moonlit
night. Yes, indeed.
You can go out and read the paper by moonlight if you weren't in here watching the news on TV, which is where you should be right now. I have a pretty nice looking 5-day outlook for you with one subtle change coming in tomorrow, and we'll talk about that in a moment.
I'm Ted Koppel. Coming up on Nightline, they know it's coming and coming with a destructive force, and they're telling us to be prepared. But how accurate are they? Forecasting El Nino on Nightline tonight.
On the border, the vaqueros perfected the art of roping cattle and cooking on the range. Of course, sometimes they had a craving for seafood, too. Now, On the Border brings you the best of land and sea with Durango steak and shrimp. We mesquite fire tender steak, stuff it with jack cheese and poblano peppers, then top it with a savory sauce and plump grilled shrimp. Only at On the Border, we do things a little differently.
Hello, I'm Channel 8 Scott Sams. Glaucoma causes blindness without any warning signs, yet its effects can be prevented. Coming up tomorrow on Daybreak, we'll tell you about a simple test. Plus, we'll have your first forecast of the morning tomorrow morning at 5:30.
Forget your troubles, come on, get happy. You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day. The sun is shining, come on, get happy. The world is waiting to take your hand. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. We're going to the promised land.
It's the new fragrance for women. Clinique Happy. Wear it and be happy. Premiering at most dealers.
Everybody knows what a Cadillac is like, but wait a minute. Here's a whole new idea. It's a luxury revolution from the ground up. Katerra. It's nimble, it's quick, it's the fastest growing luxury car in its class. This is luxury that looks convention in the eye and then winks. Isn't it time you took a test drive? Katerra. It's the caddy that zigs. Now available with Smart Buy Financing. See your Texas Cadillac Group authorized Katerra dealer.
Hope you noticed in that commercial break Ted Koppel telling you he'll be talking about El Nino forecasting and global effects tonight. And in the coming weeks, we're going to be having more and more to say about local forecast for this El Nino event, which is the earliest and biggest probably on record. So everybody's interested in that. Watch Ted tonight and keep tuned to us. We'll be letting you know more about El Nino as time goes on. Well, here's what's going on overnight tonight. Trough of low pressure approaching, surface trough. We see this kind of trough west of us a lot as two high pressure systems, one side and the other. But this time, a little upper low pressure wave is pushing it along. Some showers probably coming down into Missouri and Arkansas by morning. 48 for us, partly cloudy, no rain with us, too dry. And then the winds go northerly tomorrow morning, and by noon they'll be north 5 to 10, 68 at noon. Partly sunny skies. Showers may clip eastern Oklahoma before they turn east, but that's about as close as it gets. Tomorrow afternoon's high 74. But with a fresh infusion of dry air here and some north winds, tomorrow night we'll be in the mid-40s again. So for the next several days, cool nights and mild, pleasant days. Partly cloudy at 10. Oh, there's that moon. There's the moon. I thought we might see that, and it is large. 63 degrees. Humidity is 54%. The barometer is 30-30 rising, and the wind is calm. Here's what the satellite picture showed us today. Sunlit sky for the whole day today. And that'll pretty much be the case tomorrow. You see this little trough is dragging a little cloudiness with it, and that may come over us from time to time, but I don't think it'll obscure the sky. And for the most part, it'll be sunny. Temperatures tonight look like this, 63 for us. It's 55 at Amarillo, but that's on the backside of the trough, and you'll note that it's even cooler than that over at Midland, Odessa, 56 also at Abilene. The main effect will be cooler nights for the next few nights as temperatures drop with nice dry air and light winds. Okay. Today's high temperature was 77 degrees, a couple of degrees below normal. The low was 49, 7 degrees below normal, but we missed the record by 7 as well. Air quality today was good, and the pollen count from Dr. Jeffrey Edelglass was 785 grains per cubic meter of air, 520 fungus, 210 cedar elm, and 55 ragweed. Around the country now, here's what's going on. Well, you can see that little area of cloudiness coming down with the trough that we mentioned. And the east, it's still raining. The system there has kind of become diffuse in the upper part of the east coast, but from about the Carolinas southward, quite a bit of rain. And as this upper low comes into the eastern states in the next couple of days, there won't be enough moisture to do anything for us. But it will continue the rainfall there, I think, into the weekend. Much of the east coast will have a rainy weekend, but we won't. Temperatures at 10 tonight around the country. It's 40 at Bismarck. It's 48 in Chicago. It's 43 in Cleveland. But all in all, a fairly mild night. Tomorrow, this trough moves by us. It starts to coalesce with the one in the southeast here, which will continue the rainfall in that area. But for us, just more dry air and sunshine. Overnight tonight, then, partly cloudy, 48. Tomorrow, a partly sunny day, 74, 44 tomorrow night. Friday, sunshine, 72, low 43. A little more cool air comes in, so Saturday we may not get out of the 60s. Sunny, 68, 70, 45 at night. Sunday, 72 and a low of 48. And Monday, partly sunny and 73. Don't have any rain for you the next 5 days, but we had enough of that last week, so yeah. We're doing all right for now.
That's a good-looking fall forecast. Thanks, Troy.
Well, like it or not, the plutonium-powered Cassini spacecraft tonight is on its way to Saturn. The Titan 4B rocket carrying Cassini blasted off from Cape Canaveral this morning. Anti-nuclear activists had tried to stop the mission, fearing that an accident would shower Earth with radioactive fallout. Cassini's journey to Saturn will take 7 years and cover 2.2 billion miles. Once there, Cassini will spend 4 years exploring Saturn.
And north of Reno, Nevada, a British jet-powered car blasted through the sound barrier twice today, shattering the world land speed record. The car, driven by Royal Air Force pilot Andy Green, went nearly 760 miles an hour on the first run, almost 767 miles an hour on the second.
That would be one heck of a speeding ticket, wouldn't it?
I think so. Lose that license. Now, sports up next on the agenda. We'll check in with trainers at Valley Ranch and get an update on the latest additions to the Cowboys' injured list.
Plus, who will represent the American League in the World Series? Game 6 highlights coming next with Dale.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that they're just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone.
Oh, yes, spacious. Tip, I carried you up here. This is a room at the Horseshoe. Not regular, not queen, king size.
Thank you very much.
That's Jack Binion. He owns the Horseshoe.
He's why the action's hot. Rooms are swankin'. Sleep will be the last thing on your mind. And if you think you can get bigger, better suites anywhere else, you don't know Jack. Binion, that is.
Steve?
They're comped, right?
You gotta be kidding me.
At Luby's, whether it's seasoned with Italian herbs, prepared with a French accent, or flavored with Mexican spices, we know chicken the world over. Every day we feature a specially prepared breast of chicken served with pasta or rice, plus your choice of vegetable, bread and beverage for $5.99 for a limited time. The Chicken Lover's Special. It's delicious in any language. Luby's. Good food from good people.
Story? Get the world's fastest sport utility vehicle. Introducing the Grand Cherokee 5.9 Limited. Get low 4.8 APR financing or get great lease rates.
Monday, work was so awful. I bought myself a dress at Marshall's. Thursday, the pipes burst, so I got a few pairs of shoes.
Treat yourself to brand names at Marshall's for 20 to 60% less.
The worse things get, the better I look.
Marshall's, brand names for less.
Every day.
Starting to see some increase in those injuries, huh?
Yeah. Cowboys quarterback Troy Aikman, Cowboys fullback Darrell Johnston not practicing. Both of them hurting a little bit, but expected to play Sunday, and that's the good news. That's the way it is out there now. Cowboys play Jacksonville Sunday, and tackle Mark Tuanay won't play. George Hageman starts at left tackle. He goes against Clyde Simmons and Tony Brackens. Those two have 8.5 sacks this year, and Hageman is making just his second NFL start. Tuanay sprained a knee in the Washington game Monday night. Good news is that's all it is. No tear, but it's going to keep Tuanay out a week, maybe two.
He's got a sprain of his anterior cruciate ligament graft on his left knee. It's an incomplete, it's not a complete tear. It's a sprain to the graft that he has there.
He'd be doubtful or out?
Yeah, he'd be out this week.
Cowboys have had some good receivers play here, but they keep letting him go. Jimmy Smith plays in Jacksonville now, and he's as good there as he was supposed to be here. And here's Brian Jensen.
His days as a Cowboys receiver were nowhere near as smooth as silk. But Jimmy Smith has lived up to his nickname since catching on with the Jacksonville Jaguars in 1995.
Things didn't work out quite the way that they had planned here in Dallas for him, but he's gone on and he's made the most of his opportunities there in Jacksonville. He's played exceptionally well, but I'm not surprised by it. He had a lot of talent and felt that, you know, in the right system, given the right opportunities, he could really flourish.
I thought Jimmy was a good player. I really did. And I think right now Jimmy's in a system that's allowing him to shine, and he's doing a very good job of taking advantage of that opportunity.
The release, I don't remember why he didn't stay here, but injury or whatever.
They may not remember the injuries and the falling out Smith had with Cowboys management over his medical condition, but they remember the moves and the hands that had him leading the team in receptions during preseason of 93. that now have him second in the AFC in both receptions and receiving yards, making him the Smith with the better numbers on Sunday.
I mean, obviously he was drafted here with those that picked him felt that he had the potential and the ability to be an excellent player in this league.
Any surprise that he's the caliber of receiver he is now?
Not any surprise at all. I know that when he was here, he was making plays and running around doing a good job.
He's doing a good job for the Jags, so I know that much.
And probably has a little better memory about what happened here.
I'm sure that he will try to make us remember why we let him go and that we shouldn't have.
Jimmy Smith may not have made enough of an impression on the Cowboys to stay a Cowboy. Now they only hope he doesn't make enough of an impression to beat the Cowboys. Brian Jensen, Channel 8 Sports, Valley Ranch.
Oakland's Larry Brown still has a job, not much of one, but it pays well. 5 years, $12.5 million, and doesn't play much. Now he has been suspended for not practicing hard. Raiders coach Joe Bugle says it's a day-to-day, maybe week-to-week thing. Players union will get involved, and then it'll be over. Dallas Burns' season will be unless they win in Colorado tonight. Damian gets the scoring started with that goal there, and Dallas had a 1-0 lead in that first half. But the game's tied at one with about 3 minutes to play, and then Colorado's Chris Henderson gets the game-winning goal, and that's it. The Burns lose. They're done. 2-1 Colorado. Cleveland's Sean Kemp is getting a new contract with 7 years, $107 million. That's guaranteed money. Kemp is